welcome to another episode of Treasury Talks. I am your host, Colleen Davis, Delaware State Treasurer, and I have with me today Stacey Hunter Withers. Stacey joins us as the Tax Campaign Director with Nehemiah Gateway Community Development Corporation. Thank you so much for being here today. Can you give us a sense of, you know, what brought you to your current role at the Nehemiah Gateway Community Development Corporation, and maybe what your background is and why it's so important to serve the community in the way that you currently do?
Absolutely. And I thank you for having me, Treasurer Davis. I started with Nehemiah in around 2011, and I started as a volunteer tax preparer. An organization that I'm a member of, the Wilmington, Delaware Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, was partnered with Nehemiah Gateway to provide free tax services. And we participated in this program under our economic development trust, where we had an opportunity to work with Nehemiah clients in preparing tax returns and providing them with financial services. In my role as a volunteer tax preparer, I had the opportunity to meet a diverse group of people in Nehemiah and their clients over the years. Throughout that, the years passed by, and some 5 or 6 years later, Nehemiah tapped me on the shoulder and asked me to come and work with them as their operations director. I was excited to do it. I was excited to roll out the program further across the state, and I spent many countless hours working with the staff of Nehemiah and the community partners to expand our reach. And then before you knew it, I got tapped on the shoulder again in late last year, asking me to come and serve as the tax campaign director. I was excited about the opportunity then as well. And I ultimately said, yes, I'll do it. But my concern initially was around how can we provide tax services in historic times less such as these, when we don't, when we're limiting client contact. So I worked with a very supportive group of staff and volunteers that helped me map out a process that we believe will work. So we've developed both a virtual model and a drop-off model that will allow us the opportunity to keep tax services open throughout the tax season. But one thing we know that we have to make sure we're mindful of is the technology challenges. And appreciating the fact that our client set in the low to moderate income brackets may not have the technology we may need for them to get their taxes returned prepared virtually, we've developed the drop-off site model. At these drop-off sites, Delawareans will have the opportunity to bring their tax return documents in. We will do a quick screening to make sure we have all their information. And then we will scan their documents and have them go home, and we'll call them to complete the return. In order to have an appointment to get your taxes done this season, everyone will need to have an appointment. That's new. Clients typically just walked into a site, signed in, and waited to get their tax returns done. This year, in order to come to a site to make sure that we keep the community and our volunteers safe, everyone must have an appointment so that we can stage and limit client contact for their safety. In addition to that, for the first time, we're going to run a 100% virtual process. In that virtual process, clients can get their returns done at the comfort of their own homes. We have this motto. We say, click it, complete it, and send it. So all in that one virtual appointment, they'll be able to have their returns done completely. With that said, Treasurer Davis, we recognize wholeheartedly that our client set will have to pivot themselves. We're asking everybody to bring their patience, because we're going to start on plan A. We're going to move to plan B. We're going to pivot to plan C, and we're going to end up with plan D. But at the end of the day, our goal is to keep every tax site open as long as it is safe to. So in order to serve the nearly 12,000 clients that we serve in 2019, we have to adjust this model to do just that.
I mean, that's phenomenal. It's truly amazing when we're meeting folks' needs, but in the midst of those challenges, it's really, really remarkable. One of the things I think about is as you're achieving these things and you're meeting those needs and you're getting to people where they are, there have to be some challenges that obviously none of us expected in the midst of a pandemic, right? Do you have funding needs? Do you have technology needs? Are you inundated with volunteers, or is that a challenge? You know, can you speak about some of those specific challenges that you are rising to the occasion with?
Absolutely. And you've touched on some key ones for us. In past years, we've had up to 400 volunteers to help us facilitate this process. Today, in this new normal, we're seeing that number, not even a third of it. So in order to provide these services, our organization needs volunteers. The best way people can volunteer for us is to sign up on our website, contact us directly. Our contact information is on the website, but these services are very much needed. Even our volunteer base is concerned themselves about how we will get through this process and serve as many people. So our capacity will be limited, and it'll be limited based on the number of volunteers and based on technology constraints. But we're going to keep pressing forward. But the key thing we need to help us do that is funding. We currently receive funding for several organizations, but it's not nearly enough. In the early 2000s, when we first began this program, we had funding sources that allowed us to facilitate sites across the state in over probably close to 30 sites in some years, right? Over the past few years, having that dwindle down to 15 sites and 10 sites, and now this year to 5, is very challenging because the needs of the community haven't changed, but the resources we don't have to continue it. We'd like to see our program grow to where we can provide these services year round, but today we only have the limited capacity to provide it through the tax season. Today, the EITC program alone services nearly 70,000 clients across the state of Delaware. That means at least 35,000 of those 70,000 clients that we service qualify for the earned income tax credit. So they come to programs such as our VITA program. By the way, Nehemiah is the only VITA grant program through the IRS in the state of Delaware. So we're really excited about that. But part of that funding from the IRS assumes that our community, meaning our state programs, will also provide us with funding. And that's what's dwindled over the years. So we're hoping we have an opportunity with talks just like I'm having with you today that will help heighten that for us, that will give us more visibility and funders to be able to participate that have financial resources to help us provide these services to clients. Because we're keeping the money in Delaware when we're, you know, helping clients get these refunds.
Just sort of thinking about the earned income tax credit, we talked about this around tax season just a few months ago, because as you remember, a personal income tax deadline was pushed back due to the pandemic. But what I think about is the awareness that there are families and folks within the community that may not know that they have this benefit available to them. And just that it's such a large number of individuals that truly could benefit. I wonder if you could talk about not just how the earned income tax credit benefits individuals, but maybe also what's unique about finances, personal finances for individuals during this pandemic, maybe related to the stimulus check, that type of thing.
A key point I'd like to share about the stimulus check is we want the community to recognize that if you had not received your stimulus payment, please file your tax return this season. Because we will have an opportunity in the tax process, if someone did not receive their stimulus payment, they make us aware of that because that's a question in the process now, then they will have an opportunity to get a refund for that stimulus payment. In addition, if their situation changed, if they received their stimulus payment earlier in the year and their life changed, maybe they had a a new baby by the end of the year, they would be entitled to an additional stimulus payment, which they would get through their tax return.
I just want to go back to, you mentioned funding, and that funding is really key. I know that you you have some community partners and some private partners, maybe, you know, some larger entities that sort of help to support the work that you do. And I think it's important to highlight some of those entities that help support the work you do.
Absolutely. So one of our key funders this year, ironically, which we find very supportive of our program, is Barclays Bank. They not only provide donations to help fund the program, they also have a program with their employees where they assist us with tax preparation. So we have a tax site that we dedicate primarily to Barclays employees, because there's that many of them that assist us, where they actually do the tax preparation offsite for us. So that partnership is extremely lucrative for us, because the amount of returns that we can get done using Barclays employees is phenomenal. We just recently, in the past year or so, also received another donation to help fund our program for Santander Bank. And we're actually working with them on a very similar platform that we use with Barclays, not necessarily in the tax preparation part of it, but in the financial services part of it. But we have many partners that we work with over the years. And I'll be remiss if I didn't say them all. So I'm going to call out a few of the names just so that everyone, you know, could have a feel for them. We get funding from Barclays Bank, of course, Artisans Bank, Bank of America. We partner with Newcastle County, Executive Matt Meyer. We work cohesively with the University of Delaware, because they have a program where their students can receive credit for volunteering for our program, for our tax sites. That program is huge. As you all know, the university is remote right now, so our volunteer pool is lowered as a result of that. But we do still have some students that will be participating in a program this year remotely. So we get probably about 50% of our volunteers from the university program. So we're going to work to build that program also at Delaware State University, at Wilmington University, because we want to open up new doors. And we're hoping in the next few years, we can also expand that into the high schools. Because if high schools have students that are interested in financial segments when they go off to college, they would be a great opportunity for them to participate in our programs now.
You know, I think about these institutions, these large financial institutions, and the fact that not only have they put their money where it matters to them, but they've also called on all of their team to get out and volunteer in this way, to me means that the mission of the organization aligns with so many of our missions, you know, our personal missions to provide growth in our communities in a variety of different ways and empower people. So I love that you have been able to partner with these organizations that are just as passionate as you are. Can you tell me how folks would get in touch with Nehemiah, how they would make an appointment, what website, are you on Facebook, those kinds of things?
Yes. So the best way to reach us is on our website, and that's www.nehemiahgateway.org. And you'll be able to make an appointment to get your taxes done right from our website. There will be resource information that explains the EITC tax campaign. It will provide you with the current dates of the season, which are February the 1st through April 15th. It will also give you the opportunity to see all of the programming that Nehemiah does throughout the year in support of our tax program. The tax program is one of the largest programs of Nehemiah. When it was founded more than 20 years ago by our CEO and founder, the Dr. Reverend Clifford Johnson, it was a project of his church, Shiloh Baptist in Wilmington. Today, we still hold our main office in Wilmington on 23rd Street. Our phone number to reach us is on the website as well. We will continue to provide additional resources to the community. And we do recognize that the best way to reach us during tax season is by contacting 211, because they'll be the front line to take all of our initial calls as we're out in the field servicing customers.
Stacey Hunter Withers, thank you again, not just for the work that you guys are doing at Nehemiah Gateway, but for being such a passionate person in this space. The work that you do is so needed and so critical, especially at these times. So thank you again.